Good morning, students. Welcome back to the online class. Myself, Amrita Singh, a student of Jamshedpur Women's College, Department of Education, Faculty of MEd, Semester 2. Today, we are going to discuss about growth and development, which is taken from B.Ed. syllabus, paper 1, that is childhood and growing up. The first thing which comes in mind is growth. So, what is growth? Growth refers to changes in human weight, height and structure. Disappearance of old features and acquisition of new ones. We'll take some definitions also. According to Crow and Crow 1962, growth refers to structural and physiological changes. The next term is development. Development refers to a continuous process of changes through which task managing abilities of the individual are polished, resulting in experiences and learning. The definition given by Herlock is, in 1959, progressive series of changes that occur in an orderly, predictable pattern as a result of maturation and experience. Now, there is a chart for the growth versus development. The difference in the growth and development. So, we will consider one by one. Growth. It is a quantitative change, whereas development is a qualitative change. Growth, cellular multiplication, development, organization of all the parts which growth has produced. Growth does not continue throughout life, whereas development, it continues throughout the lifespan. Growth is an aspect of development. Development is an integrated whole, which growth is a part. The next points are: growth is observable and measurable, whereas development cannot be measured scientifically. Growth undergoes natural principles, whereas development experience and observation of an individual is done. Various parts of body become larger due to growth, whereas in development and organization in functions of various parts of body is observed due to development. Growth is increase in height, weight, structure is regarded as growth. Development is intelligence, social understanding, expertise in language and utilization of educational opportunities. There are some stages for growth and development. So, we will first consider the stages of development. You can see in the chart, it is elaborated. Okay. So, it is divided into infancy, childhood. Again, childhood is divided into pre-childhood, later childhood, adolescence, adulthood and old age or aging. So, what are the ages approximately? What are the ages or years which is included? For infancy, it is 0 to 2 years. Childhood, 3 to 12. Again, childhood is divided into pre-childhood, that is 3 to 6 years. Later childhood, 7 to 12 or up to puberty. Adolescence, 13 to 19 years or till the attainment of maturity. Adulthood, 20 to 60, and the last is old age or aging, that is 61 till death. Next is principle of development. There are various principles of development. We will discuss one by one. The first one is principle of continuity. It is a never ending process. It starts with conception and ends with death. Small, gradual and continuous in all dimensions. We'll see the educational implications also, how it is useful in education. So, we should never give up our efforts to achieve perfection in our students in different dimensions. The second principle is principle of lack of uniformity in the developmental rate. Often so silent and gradual as to be almost invisible, sometimes as fast as to be noticed quite easily. For example, shooting up in height, sudden change in social interest, intellectual curiosity. The third one is principle of individual difference. Every organism is a distinct creation in itself. Development in various dimensions is unique and specific. What are the educational implications? Each child should be helped along the developmental process within the sphere of his own strengths and limitations. The next one is principle of uniformity of pattern. Individuals follow a definite pattern which is uniform and universal with respect to its species. For instance, the development of language follows a somewhat definite sequence quite common to all human beings. The educational implications are, as child follow the uniformity of patterns, so we should follow the relevant pattern to ensure and enhance the learning. The next one is point number 5, the principle of proceeding from general to specific responses. Individual exhibits general responses and learn to show specific and goal-directed responses afterwards. For instance, when a newborn infant cries, his whole body is involved in doing so, but as he develops, it is limited to the vocal cords, facial expressions, and eyes, etc. What are the educational implications? It helps us to plan the learning processes and arrange suitable learning experience so as to achieve maximum gains in terms of growth and development. The next point is principle of integration. Patterns of behavior are broken into small ones and smaller ones are put together. A baby learns to reach for objects by maintaining an upright posture in order to facilitate the grasp. Then he has to learn how to move his arm towards the desired objects. When he is able to move his arm with intent and in the right direction, the baby must stabilize himself in order to grasp what he wants. Finally, upright and secure with his hand in the correct place, the baby can grasp the object which he wants to take. The educational implications are, it helps us to plan the learning processes and arrange suitable learning experience so as to achieve maximum gains in terms of growth and development. The next principle is principle of interrelation. Various aspects or dimensions of one's growth and development are interrelated with each other. A healthy body tends to develop a healthy mind, and emotionally stable and socially conscious personality. The educational implications are, strive for the all-round harmonious growth and development of the personalities of our children and caution us not to encourage a particular aspect. The next principle is principle of interaction. It involves the active interaction between the forces within the individual and forces belonging to his environment. Individuals' behavior or personality make up in nothing but an end product of the constant interaction between the hereditary endowment and environmental setup. The educational implications are: heredity is a factor which we cannot control, but as far as environmental factor is concerned, we should provide such an environment that is conducive to learning. The next principle is principle of cephalopodal and prosimodistal. According to cephalopodal tendency, development proceeds from head to foot direction. For instance, baby first gain control over head and arms and then on his legs. According to proximodistal tendency, development proceeds from middle to outward direction. Child is seen to exercise control over the large fundamental muscles of arms and hands and then muscles of fingers. The educational implications are: it helps us to arrange the suitable learning experiences, processes and environmental setup so as to accommodate the students. The 10th point is principle of predictability. With the help of the uniformity of the pattern and sequence of development, we can predict the future development. For example, with the knowledge of the development of bones of a child, it is possible to predict his future structure and size. The educational implications are: this knowledge helps the teacher that what is expected in terms of development, so she can plan accordingly to achieve it by organizing the experiences. The last point is principle of spiral versus linear advancement. The child doesn't proceed straight on the path of development with a constant or steady pace. Actually, he makes advancement during a particular period but takes rest in the next following period. To consolidate his development in advancing further, therefore he turns back and then makes forward again like a spiral. The educational implications are: to make adequate arrangements for the subsequent progress and consolidation of the process. The next is, what are the factors that influence the growth and development? There are various factors that influence the growth and development. Basically, it is divided into two factors, internal and external factors. Right from conception, the beginning of life in a mother's womb, the growth and development of human beings influenced by variety of factors categorized as internal factors and external factors. So what are the internal factors? The internal factors include certain factors which are: number one, hereditary factor. What is transferred to the offspring from its immediate parents in the form of genes and chromosomes at this time constitute the hereditary contribution. The second is biological factors. Physical weak or internal deformities nervous system, functioning of glands, hypoactivity and hyperactivity, appearance, defectiveness. The next point is intelligence. The physical, social, emotional, moral and language development of a child is greatly influenced and controlled by his intelligence. The next point is emotional factors. A child who is found to be overwhelmed by negative emotions like fear, anger, jealousy, etc. is adversely affected in his physical, mental, social, moral and language development. The sixth point is social nature. A person's socialization helps him in achieving adjustment and advancement in other aspects of his growth and development. This is all about the internal factor. The next is external factors. In the external factor, number one is environment in the womb of the mother. It includes physical and mental health of mother, single or multiple child, nutrition received by embryo, radiation, normal or abnormal delivery, any damage to baby inside the womb. The second is environment available after the birth, accidents and incidents in life also includes and affect the external factors, the quality of physical environment, that is medical care and nourishment, the quality of the facilities and opportunities provided by the social and cultural forces. This is all about the external and internal factors. We'll move forward to the theories of growth and development. Number one is Erikson theory of psychological development. We'll discuss it in detail. Development of self-concept, ways of interacting with the others and attitude towards world. Development of an individual is the result of his interaction with the social environment. Conceptualized development as psychosocial. Individual moves through 8 stages of psychosocial development based on epigenetic principle. In each stage, there is a specific crisis or conflict between competing tendencies. Resolution of a stage lays the foundation for negotiating the challenges of the next. Emphasis on society, relationships and interaction with people. The stages of psychological development. These are divided into 8 stages. Number one is trust versus mistrust. The second step is autonomy versus shame and doubt. Third step is initiative versus guilt. The fourth step is industry versus inferiority. Fifth one is identity versus identity confusion. The sixth step is intimacy versus isolation. Seventh, generativity versus stagnation. And the last step is integrity versus despair. This is the chart for all the stages of development of Erikson psychosocial development. We'll discuss it in detail. Okay. Stage 1 is trust versus mistrust. These are the first years of life in which the question comes, is my world predictable and supportive? The second is autonomy versus shame and doubt. Second, this comes in the second and third years. Can I do things myself or must I always rely on others? The stage three is initiative versus guilt. These are the fourth through sixth years. The question is, am I good or am I bad? Stage four is industry versus inferiority. It includes age six through puberty. Am I competent or am I worthless? Stage five, identity versus confusion. It includes the stage of adolescence. The question is, who am I and where am I going? Stage six, it includes early adulthood, intimacy versus isolation. The question is, shall I share my life with another or live alone? Seven, generativity versus self-absorption. It includes the middle adulthood. The question which comes in mind is, will I produce something of real value? The last stage is stage eight, that includes late adulthood. Integrity versus despair. The question is, have I lived a full life? This is the whole chart for the development. We'll discuss it in detail. Stage 1, psychological crisis. It includes birth to 18 months, that is infancy. Trust versus mistrust. Significant relationship, maternal person. What are the main features? It includes mother is the important person and the infant. Depends on her for food and affection. Ego, strength, hope. If the basic needs are not met, an attitude of mistrust built towards the world. What are the implications? Parents should ensure a trusting relationship with the child. Satisfying the needs develop trust. Anxiousness and anger develop mistrust. Stage 2, as you have seen earlier also, from 18 months to 3 years, which includes the toddlerhood. Psychological crisis, self-autonomy versus doubt. Significant relationship is parental person. Main features are, children try to do things independently. Growing mobility, language acquisition, ego strength, will. If the freedom and exploration are encouraged, toddler develops autonomy. If they are overly restricted, they experience shame, self-doubt. The implications are, arrange for each child to have something which are his own and with which he can identify. Value the things the child makes. Development of early trust is necessary. The stage 3 includes preschoolers. Okay, these are from 3 years to 6 years. Psychological crisis is initiative versus guilt. Significant relationship, basic family. The main features are resolution of Oedipus, ego strength, purpose. Takes initiative in interacting with the environment. If his tendency is censored through criticism or control, develop a sense of guilt. The implications are, do not punish children for their initiativeness. Create a playful atmosphere. Value children's play and talk to them about their play. The stage 4, it includes 6 to 12 years, elementary school age. Psychological crisis is industry versus inferiority. Significant relationship includes neighborhood and school. The main features are peers become important and the child tries to measure and evaluate himself with the peers. Ego strength, competence. The tendency of competence comes in the mind in this stage. Children seek to establish a clear identity. Children learn various skills, develop a sense of pride in his competencies. The implications are assign roles for them and appreciate for their effort. Make confidence in them by giving opportunities to express their abilities. Praise them for doing their best and encourage to finish the task. Strengthen the school environment. The stage 5 includes 12 to 18 year adolescents. Psychological crises, identity versus identity confusion. The relationship is with peer group. The main features are children seek to establish a clear self-identity, understands his own unique traits. Begins with puberty, there is a role of confusion. Ego strength is fidelity and loyalty. Failure to discover self-identity results in identity crisis and role confusion. The implications include help the students to identify their roles that are socially acceptable. Give them reinforcement towards positive roles. Prevent them from unlimited imaginations. Assign duties and responsibilities. The next is stage 6. It includes 20 to 40 year young adulthood. Psychological crisis is intimacy versus isolation. Significant relationship occurs between partner in friendship and sex. Main features: selection of a mate, establishment of an occupational pattern, harmonious relationship with others, intimacy, finding oneself but losing oneself in another person, ego strength, love, avoiding intimacy, fearing commitment lead to isolation, loneliness and even depression. Implications are develop harmonious relationship, develop the habit to love and to work. Stage 7. It includes 40 to 50 year middle adulthood. Psychological crisis, generativity versus stagnation. Significant relationship, divided labor and shared household. The main features are interest in establishing and guiding the next generation, focus on career and family, involved in creative pursuits, voluntary work art, science, education, etc. By falling to achieve these objects, one becomes stagnant, disinterested in others, concerned only with self. Ego strength, care. Implications: be active in home and community. Stage 8. It includes people from 60 onwards. Psychological crisis, integrity versus despair. Significant relationship, mankind. Main features: time of introspection, acceptance of accomplishments, failure, and ultimate limitation. Except the finality of death, ego strength, wisdom. It feels his life as unproductive, feel guilty about past, become dissatisfied with life, and develop despair. Implications include, introspection is necessary, listen to elderly people. So we are done with Erikson's psychosocial theory of development. The next one is Kohlberg 3-level and 6-stages moral development theory. It includes level 1, level 2 and level 3. We'll discuss it in detail. Level 1, pre-conventional level. Stage 1, punishment and obedience orientation. Children obey because adults tell them to obey. People base their moral decisions on fear of punishment. Stage 2, individualism, purpose and exchange. Individuals pursue their own interests but let others do the same. What is right involves equal change. Level 2, conventional level. Stage 3, mutual interpersonal expectations, relationships and interpersonal conformity. Individuals value trust, caring and loyalty to others as a basis for moral judgments. Stage 4, social system morality. Moral judgments are based on understanding and the social order, law, justice and duty. This is the level 3. It includes post-conventional level. Stage 5, social contract or utility and individual rights. Individual reasons that value, rights and principle transcend the law. Stage 6, universal ethical principles. The person has developed moral judgments that are based on universal human rights. When faced with the dilemma between law and conscience, a personal individualized conscience is followed. This you can see in the picture, that is conventional, pre-conventional and the post-conventional stage. Okay, this is the Kohlberg's level of moral development. You can see in the chart, all the stages are explained properly. The pre-conventional stage with the stage 1 and stage 2, conventional stage, stage 3 and stage 4, and the post-conventional autonomous or principled, which includes the stage 5 and stage 6. Along with that, the characteristics of the stages are also explained properly. We'll go with the stage 1, that is the pre-conventional stage, stage 1. Punishment, obedience and orientation. Stage 2 is instrumental, relativist orientation. Okay, the second is second stage, and stage 3. Interpersonal confidence orientation, authority and social order maintaining orientation. The last is the post-conventional stage. It includes the stage 5 and stage 6, that is social contract, legalistic orientation, and stage 6 is universal ethical principle orientation. So it is also a diagrammatic figure. Okay, so we can see in detail. The first one is avoiding punishment, self-interest, good boy attitude, law and order, morality, social contract, okay, so, and principle. Lastly is the principle. So we are done with the chapter growth and development. We have discussed over here What is growth and development? The theories of growth and development, principles of growth and development, and two important theories that are Erikson theory and Kolbach theory. Okay, so this is all for today. We'll meet in the next class. Okay, thank you.